Thank you for coming to this presentation. Thank you, Riccardo, for the introduction, and Andrea for arranging everything. So today I'm going to present the most recent result of an activity I'm carrying on with jointly with Andrea on audiovisual personal identification, focusing in particular on wearable cameras. So let's introduce quickly the application scenario, recall a little bit what the person identification task is. So our goal is to identify to recognize the identity of a person being seen or heard by a device equipped with audio and visual sensors, typically co-located. So we can assume that we have an enrollment stage when the models of the persons we want to recognize are acquired, and then during tests we want to recognize the identity, given that the person could be silent, could be out of the field of view, there could be interference sources. Basically, we have a set of speakers and want to find the identity to maximize the probability of the observation for given the speaker. Okay, so this is the traditional speaker person. I have an audio background, so I tend to use speaker instead of person. I apologize, but I think you can understand anyway. This is the, let's say, traditional person identification task. In this case, a little bit between speaker verification, which is common in audio processing, and person re-identification, more typical of the image processing community. Anyway, when we move to wearable cameras, we want to consider wearable cameras, the person identification task is far more complex. Here I reported two samples of the VideoTimid dataset, which is it has been released a few years ago, but it is still used for audiovisual person identification, compared to some data we collected using a GoPro camera. I will provide more details later about this, how these data were collected. So you see that the conditions are particularly more difficult. We go from constrained scenarios to basically unconstrained scenarios. And we have some specific challenges to take care of. Here I listed some for the video part. We have a variety of poses, distortions, the camera moves, the speaker could be close, very close or very far. Light conditions change continuously. These changes are rapid. Now light, no light, okay. The camera keeps moving because, it's worn by a person. Then of course the person could be out of the field of view or only partially visible, maybe partially visible because the person is very close to the camera. And then typically we can expect that the amount of training and adaptation material is small. We cannot assume that you can collect data for each person in each possible condition. For what concerns the audio modality, the audio data, the audio information, we have more or less similar problems. We have a variety of background noises and acoustic conditions, indoor, outdoor. There could be interference sources when interacting with people naturally in a conversation. The microphone moves with the camera, so there is noise also due to this movement. And another critical aspect, another issue is with respect to what we found in other data sets, in other the scenarios typically addressed in audiovisual personal identification, we want to deal with conversational speech, which is more difficult to deal with. We have pauses, hesitations, people sometimes they don't speak very clearly. You know, if you have a pre-record session where you're recording a person reading some text, then that is typically easier, everything is more clean. Okay, and also in this case we can expect to have a small amount of training and adaptation material. So basically this slide is to say that advanced, very articulated, state-of-the-art features or models based on eigenfaces, speaker embeddings, all these things, often are not applicable in this scenario. Okay, if the person is 5 meters away, you cannot extract eigenfaces. You just see a blob, and there's not much you can do. Okay. So this is the problem we wanted to deal with. Now, before we present, before I present what we propose to do, let's go quickly through an overview of the typical solution for the audiovisual person identification problem. So, typically we have these two systems. We have speech sentence. Okay, they're related images. Feature extraction followed by a classification stage, okay, with some predefined models. So how can the two modalities, the two pipelines, be combined? So one common approach is to use early fusion. So feature vectors provided by the two feature extractors are concatenated, and then typically there is a dimensionality reduction stage using principal component analysis or linear discriminant analysis. Here I report some a reference to reduce the dimensionality of the feature vector and to remove the information which is not complementary between the two modalities. Okay, this is what the principal component analysis does. Okay, so this is a sounds very attractive. You have in one single feature vector, you have all the information of both modalities, complementarity and everything. However, in many cases that's not straightforward. The feature vectors are of completely different nature, different frame rates, so you can just take and combine them. There must be typically some sort of processing. The dimensionality of the combined feature vector is larger, so of course this creates also a problem in training the models and in the classification stage. Again, we saw before that the information is in this task is not persistent. The speaker could be silent or the target out of the field of view. So we have this feature vector in some cases could be partly empty. So there are a lot of problems which make this solution not so popular. It is instead common in audiovisual speech recognition. In that case, that's common because it makes sense to have both information from audio and from video during the decoding stage. Okay, it's a different approach, a different kind of problem. Instead, a more common solution in audiovisual person identification is late fusion, so score combination, basically. So you have the two systems, the information, audio and visual information are processed independently, individually, and then you find a way to combine the output scores of the two classifiers. This is popular because it's rather, let's say, simple. It's modular, no? You can just plug things together. You can develop the two systems individually in order to make them suitable to the peculiarities of that information. So for speech information, you can use a classifier specifically designed for that. For the image information, you could do something different. And then you just merge the information at the end, no? So from this point of view, this is sort of preferable with respect to the previous one. There is an overwhelming amount of solution for combining the scores in literature, so I couldn't report everything. I just tried to cluster a little bit the solution, so you can find the methods where the scores or the decisions are fused in a sort of empirical way. So you take the average, the product of the scores, okay? Or you can have a further classification stage. That's of course more robust. You have the scores are treated as feature and you use this information to extract further scores, okay? Or to further classify. Here there are solutions, already last year there was this solution based on recurrent neural networks. So we have very advanced and articulated combination strategies. Of course, the problem here, you need some material to train the classification the score classification part, okay, which could be not always available. And okay, so given that this is what is available in literature, we decided to, when we addressed this problem, we decided to try to do something a little bit different, something that exploit the complementarity of the information in a more better exploit the complementarity of the information. So we decided to take into account not only late score fusion, but also try to understand if there is a possibility to improve the models using the multimodality, the complementarity of the information provided by the multimodal from the audio and the image data streams. So why did he want to do that? Well, first of all, as I mentioned before, when dealing with wearable devices, everything changes, appearance, environmental condition, and so on. So adapting the models seems a reasonable way to try to catch up these changes. Okay. Another interesting aspect of model adaptation is you can deal with the small training data sets we expect to be dealing with. You can start with weak models and then reinforce them as new data are made available. Okay. And we use this the multimodality to do this in a more robust way. And another very important aspect of this kind of solution is that it helps also when, if it works, it helps also when one of the modalities is no longer available. If you just work on score fusion, you can have the best score fusion in the world. Let's assume that the audio system is weak, the audio models are weak. Your very good fusion system is able to achieve very good performance using the video information, okay? But then if after 5 minutes the light goes off, you end up with two weak classifiers and probably there's nothing you can do. Instead, if you use the strong classifier to improve the strong video classifier to improve the audio models, the audio classifiers, when the lights go off, maybe you can do something better using the audio, okay, information. Okay, so that was the idea. And then, it doesn't replace late fusion. It complements it. Then once you improve the models, then you can do whatever you want with the scores. Okay, it's not something in contrast with the state of the art, with what is typically done. Okay. When I started working on this, I was surprised that few works are available in literature on this type of approaches. Monomodal model adaptation is common. Here I reported two examples for speaker verification and person identification, because monomodal topics are related to our work, but that's something. It's everywhere in speech recognition, image processing. Everywhere you do domain adaptation, transfer learning, these things. Okay, monomodal, everybody does it. Crossmodal, there's very, very few works available in literature. There is this co-expectation maximization, not on audiovisual processing. It's more generic framework where you have weak labels. You combine weak labels from multiple views to label an unsupervised dataset for adaptation. Or there is this work on co-adaptation for gesture and speech recognition. This is the closest thing I found to do this work. Okay. Anyway, all these approaches work offline in a batch fashion. So you have a data set for adaptation, unsupervised, without labels, and you use the information coming from the other modality or from the modality itself to label this data set and then use it for training or for adaptation. Okay. So this is not what we want to do. We don't have an adaptation material. The condition changes online, and we want to adapt our models online in real time. Okay, as soon as the condition changes, we don't want to bring a model to another domain. Okay, that's different. So what we try to do is that we try to develop an unsupervised online cross-modal model adaptation strategies. Okay, so here there is this block diagram. Forget about the feature extraction part. We'll see more details later. Let's assume that you have a feature extraction part, and then here two MLP for speaker to classify the target identity. Okay, followed by the score fusion. What we wanted to do, we wanted to define adapted time-variant models. So the model theta at time t of modality i. Here the theta, okay, in this case we have an MLP, so theta is the set of weights and bias of the network. This is a function of the previous model, okay, the current observation vector, and c is the output of the other modality, the other classifier, okay, for all the speakers and at this time. Okay, so broadly speaking, if you have this information x, we know from the other modality that this information is reliable and is speaker s, it's me, then we adapt the model, okay, of modality I, retrain. Okay, is it clear? Okay. In monomodal model adaptation, the score is the score of the modality I, the same modality, okay? So now let's go a little bit more in details how we did it using our multi-layer perceptron. So there are a little bit of formulas, but quite straightforward. So let's start from, let's go a couple of steps backwards. So if you have supervised DNN adaptation, okay, the common approach, so you have a dataset for adaptation with labels, okay. The common approach is you just do retraining, okay, using typically small learning rates to avoid overfitting the adaptation material. Okay, so you have your loss function, your negative log likelihood loss function, where y tilde is the label, the supervised label. You assume you have it, okay. So we started from there. That's what we would do if we had the labels. Okay. Unfortunately, we don't have the labels, so okay. So what do? We replace the supervised labels with the label coming from the other modality. So y at j. Okay. So we still have our loss function, negative log likelihood, where we replace the supervised labels with the unsupervised one. We have this sum over all the observations, because that's the typical offline approach, batch approach. We want to do this online, okay, using one single observation, because we want to keep following the changing conditions. So we remove the sum over all the observations, and this is the loss function we want to minimize in our back propagation of the in the DNN training. Okay, is it clear? Forgot to say that, okay, this is the typical regularization term. W are the weights of the network. This typical regularization train to avoid overfitting. It's commonly used in DNN training. Okay, so during test we have the new feature vector, label coming from the other modality, passed through to the network, negative low likelihood and back propagation, and we update the weights. Okay? Okay, not really, okay. Because if you do this, of course there is the risk, huge risk of overfitting. Okay, we want to follow the changing condition, but we don't want to overfit on those conditions because they will change again. And then labels coming from the other modalities could be erroneous, could be wrong still, okay? Also, if there is a high mismatch, we could diverge too much from from the right path. Okay, so there's this risk to take into account to handle. This is common to any model adaptation approach. There are a variety of solutions to handle with that. One can like adapt only part of the network, the upper layers or the lower layers, depending on what you want to do. You can use very low learning rates. There are a lot of things you can do. What we decided to use is KLD regularization. KLD regularization is very common in, is very common. Is used, is very common for us, because it's used in speech recognition. When you want to do unsupervised adaptation, basically the distribution, the target distribution used in the network adaptation is a linear combination between the actual target distribution, okay, of the new conditions, and the original distribution. Here p hat is the new distribution, the new target distribution for adaptation. So in this case, it's the unsupervised labels, and p overline is the original network. Okay, so it's a linear combination between the two. So basically, you want to adapt to the new conditions, but you want to keep some information of where you started from to avoid overfitting, diverging, and so on. Okay. For instance, in speech recognition, if you have your clean models and you want to adapt to noisy models, you want to keep a little bit of information of the clean models. You don't want to overfit the noise. Okay. So if you perform some math, you end up with this new loss function, which is the linear combination between the loss function we introduced before, okay, and the KLD, the Kullback-Leibler divergence between the network output and the original network, okay. So every time we say, okay, let's move a little bit towards the new condition, but not too much, okay. So here the parameter rho is crucial, okay. The parameter rho determines how much regularization you want to use. If the two extremes, if rho is equal to 1, there's no adaptation. Okay, rho is equal, there's no adaptation. You just want to, the loss function is the negative log likelihood of the original network. Okay, so your network will reproduce the same outputs. If rho is equal to 0, then you have basically retraining without any regularization. You go straight in the new conditions. So finding the optimal value for rho is not straightforward. Not in particular finding a value which is suitable for all the possible cases. So here we found we used an empirical solution. Okay, so given that rho decides how much I adapt, let's use an adaptive parameter that depends on the confidence of the labels. Okay, so we used an adaptive parameter, so it's a function of time, which depends on the scores produced by the other modality. Okay, so if the other modality is very confident, oops, it's very confident on the labeling it produces, sorry, then okay, let's trust it and let's readapt. Otherwise, we keep the previous model. Okay. Later in the implementation details, I'll report the function used for this conversion between scores and adaptation parameter. And then, I mean, this is one of the weak parts we have to work on, and later I will discuss a little bit more on this. Okay, so this is our proposed solution. We needed a suitable data set for testing it, given that what is available is not really suitable. Do you remember the picture, the samples I saw, I showed of the VidTimid data set? So we used the Quimerigo Pro, QM Group Pro. How do you call it, Andrea?
QM
Group Pro dataset, which was recorded 2 years ago when I was here. So basically, in this dataset, we have 13 subjects speaking to for approximately 1 minute. It's continuous speech, but not like reading. Sorry. It's not like reading, it's a person speaking about whatever to a person wearing a chest-mounted GoPro camera. We have 4 different conditions. So here in the picture, we have 2 cases indoor using different clothes to create a little bit of variety in the target appearance. 1 outdoor in a quiet, relative quiet location, and 1 outdoor in a very noisy location. It's basically on the Milan Road. Okay, so very noisy. So you can see already from these samples that for the image processing part, the indoor scenarios are very, very complex. You see that the light condition changes a lot when depending whether the person is moving toward the windows or away from the windows. You see that in this case, the person is barely visible. Okay. Then I have some other samples here just to show the challenges of the data set. Here again, you see that the indoor cases are very, very difficult for the image processing part. Here the person is close, so potentially you could do extreme image processing, but you cannot see the face because there's the light coming from behind. While outdoor, it's relatively simpler. And then here another case with the same target, okay, that's the same person. In this case, you don't see the face at all. Here, different clothes. And here is the same person wearing the same t-shirt, but outside, different light condition, it looks like a different t-shirt, okay? Okay, now I have a couple of videos. Just let me add this comment. So this minute, each minute is split in 5 second long clips. Okay, so in each clip we have under 25 images. Okay, so we have these segments which simulate the speaker verification scenario where you have a speech sentence and you want to detect the speaker identity. So 5 seconds, and the goal is to identify the person, to recognize the identity of the person in these 5 seconds. Okay, so it's not, for the image part, it's not like one frame, it's a sequence of frames, okay? And for the speech processing part, it's same as a regular. A regular speaker recognition task. So I show you the videos, so you have a better idea of what happens. Sorry, I have to unmute. Okay, this is the indoor case. In this case, we have also here the furniture that sometimes occludes. So you see that the camera keeps on moving. I didn't put any sample of the audio material, the audio signals. However, although the sampling rate is 48 kHz, so it's potentially very good, you can hear that there is a strong low pass effect. So basically it's, 12 kHz that you have available, which is okay, the speech band, but you could do more with more information. And that's because the camera, there is this plastic shield, okay, that cover the microphone. So you also see that it's natural speech. I have to say not all the subjects were so natural, but okay. Let me show you also the case when the person is outside. Here, maybe. Okay, this is the noisy case, okay? This is the noisy case. You see that in some cases you cannot even hear what the person is saying. Okay? And here, however, from the image processing part, it's simpler. It's more static and no occlusion and so on. Okay, enough? Yeah. Okay, so let's go back to the slides. Okay. Okay, so let's see some results. This is the some details of the experimental, how we set up the our experiments. So for training the models, we use the first three segments, so the first 15 seconds for each speaker in each condition. All the other segments were used for test. We have we had to cut at the beginning, so the sequences are one minute long. We had to cut the beginning and the end to remove some noise. So we have approximately 10 segments per person per condition, so 3 for training and 7 for test. Okay, approximately. The test segments are sorted in random order. Okay, so there is a person, then another person. Okay, and we average the result over 20 sequences. This is because if I have the same person back to back, then the network learns to recognize that person, and the performance will improve considerably. Okay, so that would be not fair. Maybe in some of the random sequences we have cases like that. But in terms of evaluation, it is a multi-class classification problem. So we consider the recognition accuracy. Typically, in speaker verification, you use the equal error rate, because you want to verify the identity of a person. You don't have a multi-class classification problem, okay? So here, given that we have this MLP trained on predefined closed set of speakers, we decide to use recognition accuracy. And we evaluate the performance in two conditions, match models. So for each condition, the conditions were, sorry, I forgot to mention, C1, C2 indoor, C3 quiet outdoor, C4 noisy outdoor. So for the four conditions, we have models trained with in-domain data. And then mismatch models. Models are trained only in C1, so indoor. And then we use the same models for the other conditions. We compare the KLD proposed approach with the baseline without adaptation. So models are just trained on the three segments. Intra labels are provided by the without using cross information, but the using the same modality, okay. And cross, we are labels coming from the other modality, but without regularization. So we just retrain using the labels. Okay. Some implementation details for the audio part. We use die vectors. Anybody familiar with die vectors? No. Okay. An I vector, that is the state of the art in speaker recognition. You have a speech sentence, and an I vector basically represents this sentence in a single vector with like 200-300 features. Okay, so starting from the sequence of MFCC, you derive this. It makes no sense to go into details. If you check I vectors, you will find several pointers. Okay, the MLP is relatively small because for each segment we have only one I vector. Okay, for each segment we have a sentence, for a sentence we have one I vector, so we have very small amount of training material. So we have two layers. I used hyperbolic tangent as activation function because it worked better, probably because ReLU overfits, given that we have few data. And in this case, the parameter rho for the KLD regularization is exactly the score of the the output of the video classifier. Okay, so the score of the maximum score. So if the maximum score is 1, retrain completely. Otherwise, something in between. For the video part. Okay, first of all, there is a person detector based on aggregate ACF. Then we used a fixed upper body extraction. Okay, so given the bounding boxes, we take a part in the a fixed region in the upper part of the detected person, and features are just a concatenation of 21 beams RGB color histograms. Okay, so very simple. MLP a little bit larger than the other one, but similar. Given that we have 125 images per segment, the final score of the segment is the average of the scores. Okay, so also here could be something better that can be done. And this is probably the weak part, the regularization parameter, RAW, to derive it using the audio scores, we have to come up with this empirically defined function, because the output of the audio MLP, the scores are rather low, okay? Probably the training material is not enough. I vectors are not discriminative enough in that case, because we use out of domain data to extract these I vectors, so those are they are weak. Anyway, we found that this formula can provide suitable regularization parameters. Finally, concerning the score fusion, we have to use a rather simple sum rule. So weighted sum of the scores, where the weight gamma depends on the variance of the scores. Why do we have, well, of course, using a classification stage would have been much better, but with this particular approach it's not possible, because models change continuously, so the distribution of the model's output, the model outputs, change continuously, so we will need to continuously change the classification, the score classification, which is not possible. At least, if you have ideas, let us know. Okay, so we have to use a rather simple score fusion, final score fusion. Okay, so let's see the results. Let's start with match conditions. Okay, on your left you have the results for the audio modality. Let's consider the two modalities independently for the moment, and on the right the video part. So first of all, you can see that as expected in C1 and C2 indoor, those conditions are quite easy for the audio part. Okay, we are indoor, no noise, so performance is good. C3 outside, quiet, starts deteriorating. C4 noisy, performance is the lowest. And so here, C1, C2, performance is good, so adaptation doesn't bring a lot of information. Okay. However, you see that in C3 and C4, the adaptation, which is the yellow bar, improves the performance, and KLD regularization brings a further improvement. Okay, so that's good. For what concerns the video part, we have C1 and C2 are the most difficult, okay, as expected. Why C3 and C4 simpler? Here you see that the intra-adaptation, okay, second bar, deteriorates the performance, because the label of the video modality are weak, so it makes no sense to use them to readapt. While adaptation improves the performance, except for C4, because the video modality is weak too there, okay? So, here is everything is fine, except for the fact that here in C2, C1 and C2, KLD regularization limits the gain that we could achieve with cross adaptation, okay? So apparently here, if we adapt without regularization, it's better than using this KLD regularization. One possible explanation is that the way we compute the regularization parameter, that empiric formula I showed before, is probably too conservative, so we are underestimating the reliability of the audio labels. Okay. Another possible explanation is that here the conditions, the target appearance changes so quickly that it's better to adapt whatever you have, okay, rather than not adapting. Anyway, cross adaptation improves, and KLD typically, still KLD it's better than the baseline, okay, so it brings something. Okay, here we have results again in match conditions comparing our adaptive KLD parameter computation with some cases where the parameter is fixed for the whole test set. So we have in blue we have the baseline, in brown, red brown, we have our KLD adaptive KLD. Then we have rho equal to zero, so retraining. The orange one is rho equal to one, so no adaptation, in fact is equal to the baseline. And then we have the intermediate values on both charts. So what is interesting to see here is you see that the best value, it's clear here in the video part, the best rho is towards zero when the other modality is reliable, okay, and towards one, here is 0.75, when the other modality is less reliable. Okay, so it means that this idea to compute rho given the confidence of the other modality makes sense. Okay. Then these are the results in what time is it? It's an hour or 45?
It's 4 and
15. No, it's an hour or 45 minutes?
1 hour.
Oh, no. Okay. These are the results in mismatch conditions. So we train the models in C1 and then we apply the same models to all the conditions. Okay. So you see that performance deteriorates, okay, going from C1 to C3 to C4. It's even more evident here, okay, in the image for what concerns the video processing part. Here, okay, video is not performing very well in the mismatch condition, so the adaptation doesn't help a lot here because there's basically nothing we can rely on. Anyway, you see that with KLD, in general, excluding this very difficult case, C4, where everything is totally mismatched, KLD ensure, let's say, doesn't deteriorate the performance, ensure that the audio performs reasonably good. Well, consider that we have a small data set, 20 random sequences, so there is some experimental noise, okay, in these numbers. So you can go to the second decimal digit to say one is better than the other. And instead here, in the video modality, which is the one suffering more, the most for this mismatch, you see that the cross adaptation helps a lot in improving the performance, okay? And again, we have this problem. KLD improves over the baseline, but not as we would, not as the cross adaptation. So probably still we are underestimating the reliability, okay? But it's good to be conservative in some cases. Okay, anyway, this is another possible reason why KLD cannot achieve the same performance as the cross adaptation without regularization. Here we have, as I said, 20 sequences. So if a sequence is good or lucky, using the regularization, of course, I mean, being conservative is not the best the best idea. Here the KLD is designed for an average sequence. Here we have 20 sequences, some of them could be lucky, so it could be that also this fact influences the result. So in this table here, I report compare the results of cross and KLD in match conditions, audio and video. What is relevant here is the standard deviation of the results of the 20 sequences. Okay, so you can see that for both modalities, excluding few cases like this one, and only this one, the standard deviation of the KLD performance is lower. Okay, so it means that whatever is the sequence, KLD regularization, ensures that you have some a performance. Okay, something stable, constant. Without KLD, the performance depends on how the test segments are sorted. So if this test segment is lucky, you have good performance. Otherwise, you could have bad performance. Okay. Okay, we can also go quickly through the results after score fusion. Okay, let me say first of all that considering the impact of adaptation after score fusion is not really fair. If score fusion works very well, then of course the impact of adaptation is less evident, no? Maybe you don't need the adaptation if the score fusion works very well, in particular because in this case, in this data set, speech and the speech is always present and the person is most of the cases within the field of view of the camera. So you have both scores available, and so if you are able to score them properly. Anyway, you can see that again in match cases, typically the KLD information improves over the baseline. Here it's very close, it's basically the same performance. Okay, and in mismatch cases, in the mismatch scenario, okay, we have again this limitation introduced by the regularization. In C1 and C2 we can improve, and then here these two cases, here in C3 same performance, and in C4 it's very, yeah, I mean we're talking about 20% of recognition rate, so I don't know if it makes sense to say that one is better than the other. They are all bad. Okay, so to conclude, okay, so the takeaway is personal identification on wearable cameras is very challenging, okay, compared to typical person audio-visual personal identification problems addressed in literature. Cross-model adaptation helps coping with rapidly varying conditions. Okay, we saw that actually using the other information is helps improving the performance. And then this KLD regularization is an effective approach to avoid overfitting and model divergence, but is what we are using here is far from being optimal. So one of the open issues to address in the future is to find a way to compute the best regularization parameter, and find a way to compute an optimal regularization parameter. Not only based on the confidence of the classifier, of the label, but probably related also to the amount of mismatch we are dealing with. So if there is a lot of mismatch, maybe it makes sense to adapt, okay? Even if the label is maybe wrong, we can adapt to the noise or to the light conditions, okay? So maybe another thing we have to work on is to improve the baseline mono model systems. Okay, so here we have color histograms and MLP, eye vectors and MLP. We have to test adaptation on more complex, more advanced systems, end-to-end solutions, speaker embeddings, these things. Okay, unfortunately, yeah, we have to start from something and then improve step by step. Another limitation is that the test set is very small, so I mean numbers, you have to take care when interpreting the numbers because there could be some variance due to the small size of the test set. Okay, so thank you for your attention. Questions?